and women's accessible. So it's a brand. It's a brand which is recognized as a social brand, but behind that brand, there is a fantastic woman called Isabel Carter, who wanted at the start to develop a dignified work opportunity for underprivileged women. So she has been in this business or in this fight, I don't know how you, or this journey, for more than 20 years. She managed to do fantastic stuff between Chile and the US, and she managed to get a fantastic recognition in social entrepreneurship across the world. So I would like you to give a round of applause to Isabel. Thank you for sharing your experience with us. What we have here, we have new startuppers who just arrived, We have social entrepreneurs, we have normal entrepreneurs, and there is a space here and welcome. And we have all types of entrepreneurs. I'm sure that sharing your experience will be fantastic, will enlighten their journey as well. Welcome, and I leave you the floor. Can do it in French or in English the way you
want. Bonsoir, excusez-moi, mais en français, c'est pas, n'est pas suffisant pour sa présentation, mais je voulais dire qu'il est un honneur pour moi de partager l'histoire de ma femme. Aujourd'hui,
merci.
So before I move on, I don't know if I am handling this properly for whatever you need.
Yeah.
Because here is going to be for 30 minutes. So we'll be here.
Yeah.
Okay. How is this proper?
Maybe we should eat. Probably.
Because it sounds like it's fine right there. So should we put it on this hand?
For the live call. This, by the way, it's live on Facebook. For your friends, or if you want to share this with your friends.
Okay. All right. So I want to thank the lab and the U.S. United States Embassy, the GAO officers, the financial institutions, and the social enterprises, as well as all of the entrepreneurs who are putting in here for allowing me to do this. And what I want to tell you is that I visited Tunis in September, this past September, and in talking about what I did, there was a group of you that said they would be interested in me sharing a little bit more about what I did and how I did it. And that's how we find ourselves here. What I planned so that we could have some context is to start with a small video that's going to show to you what we did in Chile, where I started. And then I'll tell you a little bit of how I got to doing what I do, okay? And what I've been doing this really for almost 30 years. All right, so you want to go ahead?
As far as I can remember, we removed this from school. link more contemporary minds with artisan skills, with noble materials such as cotton and silk, and with more modern materials that created a different effect. Roland resulted in a very special line of children's clothing that's currently sold throughout the United States. From the 21 women that we started working with, today we have over 100, and we work with artisans throughout the country. The result is several products, of which I can think of the newest one, which is a very versatile scarf for women. And the most exciting one for me is a design doll for a child. They can go and create their own virtual experience designing the doll, and then in 2 or 3 weeks they will receive the doll they designed. I like that connection between the virtual experience of the computer and something that you can receive. Today's world worships technology and feels nostalgia for a tactile experience full of human content. Consumers are not only looking for quality and design, but also for products that have been constructed properly. Our products are found today in the best stores throughout the country, and they hang next to brands that invest enormously in their promotion. It fills me with pride to see the result of a shared effort by someone that is recognized and valued by the consumer today.
Science and art. When I graduated from the University of Chile, I got a scholarship to New York University. And there I heard about something called sensor integration, which is a way in which you organize learning neurologically, or not learning, but either way, that's what I was fascinated by that. I went back to Chile and married my husband and joined him in the United States where he was, where he went to get his specialty in medicine. And while he was doing that, I became a specialist in sensory integration. To my surprise, the United States government decided that there were not enough specialists in my area in sensory integration, so they wanted us to stay, and Brenda agreed, he said, remain, and then my husband, lucky enough, married to me, he got it too. We stayed there. I went on to get a master's in science from the University of Southern California. Around this time, I had my first baby. And that was a transforming moment in my life, because maybe because I was in a country that wasn't mine, because my mother wasn't near, my family wasn't near, the idea of leaving the baby all day long was an impossible thought for me. And my husband was a good provider, that was not a need. And I had to leave behind all of my professional identity, something I had dedicated many years to, that I liked and that I was good at. And that was hard. That was hard. I never regretted taking care of the baby, but it was difficult to leave behind something that had been so important and something I had put forward so much effort. Am I being clear, or should I speak slower?
And go outside to check the sound on Facebook.
Very well. Okay, because if I can drop this, that's fine. All right. So having these feelings. I told myself, okay, so yes, it is hard, but there are women. I mean, my daughter has everything she needs. What happens to a woman when she wakes up and she cannot take care of her two? Maybe she cannot feed them properly. Maybe she cannot keep them warm. Maybe she cannot educate them. I thought, now that is a real problem. That's a real existential problem. Mine is an identity, whatever. Get over it. Is what I told myself, honestly, just like that. Get over it. You know, it's a real problem. And that was a very good. Okay, very good. So that was compounded by an experience I had when visiting the outskirts of Santiago, where there was a group of underprivileged women that had extraordinary skills in embroidering. And I went there to get a dress for my baby, for my girl. And I asked one of the women, how much was it? And she said to me, whatever you want to give me. Now that had a tremendous impact on me. Here is this woman with this incredible skill, and no sense of worth. And the combination of both prompted into my head, I'm going to open the US market for this. And I had that as something I wanted to pursue. And that's how I got to the idea. Then that's where I like to be. But the next part is the obstacles. So when you have an idea and you're all at that stage now, you need the obstacles. What was my first obstacle? I told my father, I have this idea. And what did he say to me? Why do you want to complicate your life when you don't need to? Then I told my husband, I have this idea. And he said to me, don't count with my money. Which made me, as you can imagine, terribly mad. I mean, I had left my country, my family, my friends, my career to service his interests. Is my husband a bad person? He's right here, same husband. Is my husband a bad person? Is my father a bad person? No. They were men. And they thought my concessions were just wrong. Why do I share such a personal story with you? I'm sharing it because of what I learned. I learned that when you decide, that this informs everyone that is an entrepreneur, when you decide to walk a path that is not the path that everybody walks, even the people you love may not stand by you. And you may find yourself alone. But if you have the conviction that it is a good thing, it is enough. Even if you're alone, it is enough. And that is what I learned. And that is the personal. Now, redeeming my father, he ended up working for the company. And redeeming my husband, 10 years ago, when the 2008-2009 economic collapse of the US market, where all banks, I mean, the bank I had been working with for many years was closed from one day to the next, customers were like, hey, I still have all these people. You know, these people depended. Who saved the company? My husband. So I think that is a testament to perseverance and to the belief that if your belief is strong enough and nobody is with you, it's enough that you have that belief. You don't need more of that. Okay?
Yeah.
So
thank you.
So that is, you know, the obstacle is the small circle of your personal life. For for some people or it is easier than for others, but it is something one has to address when one decides to walk a path that is not the path that everybody walks. Financial, always a challenge, and it never ends. It has never ended for me. You are subjected to many forces that are outside of your control. So it's a challenge constantly. So how did I move without a lot of support, without financial support? Banks, you can imagine 25 years ago, don't even think of the conscious level in which you're operating today, where you're talking about social enterprise and you're all here, and you all understand what it is. 25 years, the term didn't exist. And when I went to a bank to say that I wanted to create a business to do good, do I need to explain the results of that attempt? I mean, to the point in which speaking to the vice president of the bank, he's telling me, you know, flipping this folder, you know, with great importance, and saying to me, I'm sorry, we don't have really anything to support you. And I look at him and I said, I think you need to turn the file upside down to read what it says. He wasn't even reading, he had the file the other way, but I could see. So that is, I mean, nowhere financial institutions at the time were interested in anything similar to what we are all talking about. It is different now. It's a little bit better. There's microfinancing. There's just options that were not there when I started. But so I still have to move, right? So what did I do? I started little by little. And I started in San Francisco, Northern California. I felt I was learning enough, I moved to Los Angeles. Okay, I had California. Then I went to Dallas, the middle of the United States. As I moved, I grew little by little. And I learned, because it's, you remember that my background was in science. So I learned how movies work, which is the path you long walk. I was afraid of New York. Because it's big, it's powerful, and it's, you know, just maybe volumes I couldn't handle, I was afraid. So I ended up in New York when I felt I need just enough to move. And I did. After that, you know, orders started coming and things started moving in my direction. After a while, finance institutions, if you seem to be moving the right direction, they offer you a line of credit and you have a little bit more. My path was at that. Okay, so that was financial. I mean, of course, any one topic can be good for a whole session. But let's say culture. Something I encountered, and this I am sharing with you the things that I think are very important to keep in mind when you're involved in creating a product. Maybe for also true for other things, but I just don't know those things. The number one was, in Chile, the culture meant that more or less was the same as whatever it was we were doing. It's more or less the same. The market I am, the United States, says what I want is exactly the same. So more or less does not cut it. It's got to be exact. Chilean culture, if it's almost the same, it's the same. In the United States, it isn't. It took me years to bridge this. Some people are faster in learning than others, but as a company, it took me years to bridge the more or less to be the same. 25 25 years, we are the same. But it took a long time. And I think it's important to understand that without becoming resentful or mad about it. You're going to find the cultural differences. People that are used to a very simple life that won't even understand what you mean when you say you cannot leave a knot untied. You know, that's like, okay, well, it's not a big deal. Look at all the embroidery I did. So you have to have patience and just expect that there is a learning curve to meet cultural differences, but that it happens. That's one thing I wanted to mention because I think it has been important for us. Now, the second thing that was important to us was how to pay people. How do you pay artisans? Artisans that are underprivileged. I'm not talking about people with great educational opportunities. People that are very simple in their way of life, no education. You need to pay them. When you have five artisans, it's not a problem. You can pay what they understand, cash. But when you grow, and you have many artisans, and you pay every Friday, then what happens? You become the target of theft, correct? Mm-hmm. If everybody knows that on Friday, you're going to be bringing so much money to this place because you're going to be paying, you know, several people, you are the target. So one of the big transformations was to have artisans lose their fear of what a bank gets. People that have very simple lives look at those heavy doors of the bank and they know that that's not where they belong. That's for other people. That's for people that are
rich,
educated, whatever, but not for them. Chile does something in banking that I consider has been very, very useful, and I don't know if this is something that Tunisia has, but Chile, every person has an ID number. It's the one that people use for voting, etc. It's your ID. You can, in the bank from the government, you can open an account with this number and you pay nothing. This was our savior. You may discuss it with him. Because it sounds so elemental. But in the end, what we want is for these artisans to become part of society and to lose the fears of being like the others, like the people that have more opportunities. So, it took years again. These are the two things that I wanted to mention because this is nothing that happened. I kept trying, but you know, I had to bring somebody from the bank to the company, take people by the hand, Now, they're all happy. Why? Because they are less vulnerable. They are not going back to where they live with a purse full of cash. They are safer. So, I am mentioning these things because as you grow and as you work with more people, these are things that I have had to take care of. They have not been easy, but they have been important. Bringing a product to market. We were focused on bringing to market, the United States, a very competitive market, a complete product. A product that met the highest standards of design and quality that have been constructed ethically. This was the overall global goal. And in this goal, I think it's important not to ever lose the focus that in the end, this global goal is built on little things. And I will tell you a story. We have a woman that came to us. She have any skills, but she had a son with muscular dystrophy. And her husband had abandoned her because he blamed her for the muscular dystrophy. So we taught her how to crochet little boots. Just one style, just one thing. Crochet little boots, beautiful, just one. For 18 years, this woman, we had to buy her the raw materials because, you know, she didn't have that. For 18 years, this woman supported her son until the illness took him with a pair, doing this pair of boots, nothing more. When the demand was too high, she trained all the neighbors to do the same. And this is something that one is projecting the big goals. It's important to know that in the end, things can be as simple as a pair of booties that transform a person's life. In this same route, I found a young man. Chile is a very conservative country. I found a young man who was extraordinary in his creativity. He made dolls. His grandfather had been a toy maker and his mother had been a seamstress. And he loved making dolls and he just did a wonderful job. I really could not see his future in Chile very easily. So I came up with the idea and created a program that you just took a glimpse. So you can go into a computer, into your our website, you go to dolls, you design your doll, and 3 weeks later you get the doll that you designed. Your short hair, long hair, sleepy, open eyes, brown skin, white skin, blonde, whatever. So you put and you receive it. I liked this not only from the standpoint of the opportunity it brought to Javier, that's his name, but also because I liked the idea of young children going to the computer and understanding that there are consequences to what you do there. It's not just a frame that you play with, that is disconnected from the world. No, you create a doll, the doll arrives in your door. I like that as a sort of an education, an experience. So this goes back to focus. You know, what are we doing? I am trying to provide an opportunity that sometimes is as simple as a pair of boots, as simple as opening, designing, creating a program that creates a market for a person's skills. That's it. Now, what else is important? Because one thing, this is for you being your first day, one thing is to have an idea, develop it, get it out there, and be successful. Now, it's another thing to do it for 25 years. Stay in power. How do you work out the balance to stay? Not the punch just to get there, but the ability to remain. It's in a permanent effort to balance staying current, because the market changes. You cannot get comfortable doing what you're doing today. In a few years, you will have to bring innovation to that very same thing. So staying current, being able to produce more as you grow, and sustain the quality. Whatever it takes for you to sustain the quality of what you do is absolutely critical. If it takes for you to sleep at the company, then you sleep at the company. Because being able to meet the demand on time, but not bringing the quality, is the same thing as shooting yourself in the foot. So the permanent effort is in balancing, staying current, increased production, and maintain the quality. This is a permanent effort. It will be at the beginning and it will be as you grow. It's a difficult balance. Okay? And vital. What is vital? And this, I cannot reinforce enough for people that have the sensibility to concern themselves with social enterprise. What is it? When you go out to the market, whatever it is you bring to the market, you have to go out there and compete on the merits of your product, not on your desire to do the good. Whatever you bring to market, you want to be the best. And what you do, you want it to be excellent, you want to be the product. The fact that you are helping other people, that is an added value, but you can never reverse that in terms of marketing. Never. You're doomed if you do. You cannot present your product as a charity product. You have to present your product as the value in itself. And I'll tell you, when I saw the reaction of people when I said I wanted to create this company to do the good, and I saw the reaction from the banks and everybody, I never said that again. I just never said it. I just competed on the merits of my product. And that was it. Now, later, it became fashionable to create companies that do good for others. And you had all these famous people, I do this, and, you know, and I help these people, and I do that. And I was like, no, wait a minute. That's what we have been always. And at that time, and this is only like maybe 6 years ago, we hang a tag from every piece we sell that identifies the company as a social enterprise. But not before. Before, the fight was in the merits of the product. And that is what is under this tag, vital. Make sure whatever you do, that is something worthy for others, aside from your desire to do good in the process. That is my experience. I mean, I don't know. Let's see. Thank you, Lisa. Okay. We set out to offer people an opportunity that was better than what they had, naturally. And in my idealism, I honestly believe that all that a person needed to get ahead was a good and fair opportunity. I really, in my heart, felt that's all it's needed. And I would love to tell you that that's the case. Unfortunately, it isn't. That was not my experience. A third of the people that we started with and afforded the opportunity did take it. And they did improve the quality of their lives. And that meant very different things for different people. Maybe for some people it was building a bigger house or fixing the roof or buying bicycles. I don't know, whatever they did. But they took it. They grew. They're still with us. The average of the people that work with us is over 15 years. The other third abused the opportunity. They stole, they cheated, they were dishonest, and eventually they weren't part of what we were doing anymore. But it was the last third that surprised me the most, and that is the people that couldn't handle the responsibility of their own reality. Even though the opportunities were there, their reality called for them to say, their reality demanded that or wanted that they say, oh no, I was born poor. I don't have this. I don't have the education. But there was always a reason for them not to take it on. It is this group that was the most painful one, to see that some people are just not ready to take the responsibility of their reality, and they prefer to be the victims. Why do I share this with you? To avoid the pain, because it's painful. You put so much effort, and then you see that some people, no matter what, I see some faces, their heads going like this. Yeah, some people, you know, some abuse it, and others cannot handle it. But a third do take it on, and that is worth it, without a doubt. Now, what are the benefits of a social, of an ethically manufactured product? Can anybody give me an idea here, social entrepreneurs? What is the benefit of an ethical product? Any ideas?
Help people?
Yeah, better people's lives.
Better people's lives, yes. But what people?
It depends on the target group we are working on. Okay. Maybe unemployed or economically inactive.
Yes.
Yeah, it depends on the people we are working
with. Working with?
Yeah, we are serving.
Okay, yes?
Positive impact it has on
the positive impact on the community, very well.
It changes consumers' mentality.
It changes consumers' mentality, right? Any man with an opinion?
Sustainability.
I'm sorry?
It brings sustainability. It's everlasting.
Everlasting sustainability. Yes? The benefits of an ethical product. The idea of an ethical product is that it benefits the person that makes it, the person that markets the product, and the person that uses the product in a balanced way. So it's not the person in the middle that's paying very little to who manufactures and demands very much from the person that buys. The idea is that an ethical product, it brings a balance of something good to everybody involved. And that is, you know, the concept that we work with
when
pricing.
Win-win situation.
Yes. Yes. Correct. Now, because we did this at a time when doing these things, these kinds of things were not common, we were recognized, you know, in many places, but this led us to becoming a B corporation, a certified B corporation. Does anyone here, has anybody here heard of a B corporation? Yes.
It's a number given for startups or enterprises that works to preserve the right of the people working on them and
yes. That kind of stuff. Yes. So
it's based.
I'm sorry,
it's US based.
It's an international organization based in the United States. But what it is, it's a corporation that has created a standard that identifies companies that exist to do the good. So what does it mean? What is the process? The process is a little painful. I couldn't do it. When we were so busy, people kept saying, you are a B corporation, you should. Yes, I know, but we were too busy in the managing of everything to even involve ourselves with this. I had to hire a person just to do this, but we did it, and I'm glad we did. It's about 200 questions about everything that you can manage, how long you've done it, how much people earn, how you handle the whole thing, and then you have to prove evidence of everything you're saying. So it's not just answering the question, but absolutely proving that what you're saying is what is happening. We were one of the fastest companies in the world to be certified B, because we've done it for so long that they were that we qualified through and through. So we became a certified B corporation. What is good about that? Not only the validation, but also the fact that there is a network. So if I have to print something, oh, I want to print somebody that is a certified B Corp, because I know that person is doing the good. So in the end, as a B Corporation, they look to see how you, like in our case, we are certified as a company that improves a social condition. Other companies are certified because they improve an environmental condition, or both. But it's a network. So when I go to buy a fabric, by every means that I have, I want to make sure this fabric comes from a place where people are dealt with fairly. And this extends to everybody, all of your chain of suppliers. And it creates and it expands as a network of companies that insist that it's good. And I cannot recommend enough, as a matter of fact, I'm going to talk to the person in charge of B Corps in Chile to get in touch with you so that you can all get involved, because it is the future. So much it is the future.
Thank you.
Absolutely, so relevant. So much it is the future that Forbes magazine, I don't know if you know what Forbes magazine, a preemptive publication of economics, says that being in the top 10% of B corporations, which is a list that Forbes magazine publishes every year, is the list that every company in the world should aim at being. We have been in the list in 2016 and 2017.
Awesome.
Thank you. Yes. It's not that, it's just to confirm that there is value in doing things right, and that there is a community of people involved in doing that. And to have it, you know, there. So you are not alone, because the path that I walked was a very lonely path. And when I see a community involved, it's very, very exciting. This is about 1,600 companies all over the world. And so it's very, very exciting. Yes.
Is B Level applying only for social companies? So first of all, you should be a social company, and then they control how you do it to give you the B level, or any enterprise that implements B level standard can be a B corporation.
My road to this, I was a company, I was a social enterprise, and I applied. They send you the questions, which should take time, and then they certify you. So I think that you have to have some base that they can evaluate. I don't think that you could be certified if you haven't done anything, because I can't imagine how you would answer all those questions. Mm-hmm. So if you're just starting, but what I think is worthy, since you're just starting, is to understand how to organize your information so that when the time comes, you can be certified.
Yes, of course, but by definition, any enterprise create value. They're answering a problem in the company. Maybe it's not social, but they are creating value. So my question was, if any enterprise can apply to have the B level, if they are implementing the standard, or only social enterprise can apply. You have, first of all, be social, and then we can try to implement all other criteria.
Yes. What I understand is that the company has to improve either a social condition or the environment, that there's a commitment to improving a social condition in a community or wherever that may be. This company doesn't matter what it does, maybe you make buttons or lights, but if in the process you're committed to creating, improving the social condition for people that work for you, that's enough. If what you're doing and the way you're doing it improves the environment. You have, you know, the way you dispose your garbage. But all of those things, then you can be both. But my understanding is that you have to provide evidence that your enterprise is committed to improving a social condition or the environment.
Brings us to the definition of a social enterprise, which is an enterprise with a social mission, not like CSR programs or something like that. Yeah, for sure, each company is creating values, but we are talking about social values and values that are bettering people's lives. Okay?
25 years doing something different eventually gives you some recognition by the NGO. So, of course, we are today in the best stores of the United States. For anybody that has traveled there that knows what Saks Fifth Avenue is, or the Marcus, or Barney's, or Bergdorf, they're the top market. We are there. You can find us at, in the internet. We're the best boutiques. We're in some stores in different countries as well. So we are in many. We are sold in the very best stores. And what I think is relevant to that is that we hang next to Gucci, we hang next to Ralph Lauren, we hang next to companies that invest an enormous amount of money in their promotion, something that we have not done. So if we're there, it's because of the merits of the product. So that's why you don't need to be concerned if you want to bring something very good to the market.
In Europe?
Yes, we have some stores in Europe, but mostly boutiques. We've never really marketed. We are changing that now. We are in the process of researching some platforms that would make us more present in Europe. Okay, so magazines, of course, we have also been in Vogue magazine and other magazines that have featured our products or the story of the company throughout the years. All of this is in the website. And then here I have Bachelet, because when President Obama was elected to the presidency, our presidency at the time, Michelle Bachelet, bought our dresses to Obama's daughters. So that was a form of recognition. And then here I have Forbes because of what I said before. They really value, business-wise, the value of business that are a force of good as the trend that the market is looking for. I mean, today, people are really starving for wholesomeness. And there is a real strong rejection of what we understand as traditional business, where some of the organizations out there to make an enormous amount of money at the expense of other human beings or the environment, etc. So there's a big trend, and I think that for Forbes, which is a forefront magazine of business, to make such a big deal out of companies that exist to do the good is identifying the world trend in this direction. Oh, well. Here we are at University of Berkeley. I'm introducing one of the people that works for us in Chile.
She's here representing the many women that have gained, hopefully, a better life because of our enterprise.
That's it. This is one of the women. She traveled from Chile to Berkeley to share the State of the Women Recipe Award. All right. The future. Your world, no longer mine, but yours. I think this is relevant. I think this is relevant. In 2001, when the towers in New York fell, it brought about a transformation in consumer behavior that nobody expected. What happened? People didn't want to get in planes. The overall reaction was people didn't want to get in a plane. So what happens to companies like mine who had the biggest market in October, 4 weeks after. The city was still filled with dust. Nobody was there. So the connection between the buyer and the seller was broken. And what happened? Everybody went to the internet. And so, not only the store buyers went to the internet, but people went to the internet. And I can tell you that this past year, our company has sold more in the internet than to all stores. And I think that this is something that I want you to really, really take in, because it is your future. So, behavior, the consumer behavior has been transformed by the presence of the internet. Maybe some countries move slower, like Chile. You know, people still like to go and shop and do these things and check. It is a matter of time. It's inevitable. People will shop for what they need on the internet. The demands of modern times are that people are short of time. And how much they do, I will just to give you an idea. My daughters, they buy everything in the internet. I don't think they've stepped in a store for 2 years. Toilet paper, yogurt, milk, a dress, whatever. You all know it. You all know Amazon. You all know Alibaba.
Yes.
It's the way of the future. What is important is for you to find the right platform for your products and to think global. Values. Values go back to what I just said. A world that is hungry for wholesomeness, hungry for things that are good, for ethical things. People, most people have, with a certain education, everything they need. To just have a more has become less important. But the idea of buying something that makes the world a little better has gained value. And I think it's something to keep in mind, and something for which you're all lucky, because it's your time. All right, so values have changed the consumer, and it matters today who makes it and how they make it. And you see all these huge companies, like, what is this big company, we're the ones that have all the tea in the world. It's a huge corporation, and Uber, something like that. I'm sure that'll be from my memory. But regardless, it's the one corporation that practically owns the tea of the world. I think it's a rich company. They make all the
money.
Unilever. Yeah. That's it. It's Unilever.
They own
everything. Yeah. Let's say that they are the world company. I was in a presentation in which they said they were aiming in 2020 to have all of their teas be organic. For environmental reasons, for health reasons. So, even big companies are focusing on doing that, because that's added value to whatever it is they do.
Because in order to do that, they get the norms lowered. And so you can call bio today, it wasn't anything like that 10 years ago.
There may be, there's always a trick, but the goal is there. Mm-hmm. And people are making a point of promoting themselves for things that are good. Mm-hmm. And that is a change. How good they do it, how truthful they are, that's why we have the course. Mm-hmm. They're testing. But Patagonia, is Patagonia no one in Tunisia? Yeah. Patagonia Sports?
No.
Sports, okay, it's a big company for outdoor clothing. B Corp. Banks, they want to be a B Corp. Even universities are looking for the classification. Okay. So that's what happened there. The consumer, you know, was shocked into a situation where behavior was transformed and values are changing, and this becomes the times you're in. And this brings me to here. Your path is easier. You're at a great grade, and I don't mean this just as a speaking thing, because that doesn't make any, it's not relevant. I say it because I believe it. Your path doesn't need to be as slow as my path was, or as tough, or as lonely.
I'm not sure. Yeah, because as an entrepreneur, you'll be always lonely.
But look where you are. Look where you are. You are with similarly minded people. You're not the only one thinking social enterprise or enterprise. You are in a group. Today there are schools that are called School in Berkeley, School for Responsible Business. I mean, we are dealing with an overall reality that embraces the concept. But more importantly, you are dealing with a marketing, with marketing options that were not there when I started. I mean, you have the internet, you need a web, you need to understand social media, but you also need this. Yes. You can have the best website, you can have the best product, but if you only have one buyer, you can't support the company. So, what happened to me? I don't sell in Chile. I don't. If I define this is something extremely relevant and important to move ahead, you have to define who is your customer. Because I don't know how Tunisia works, but I'm sure Tunisia is big. But the world is even bigger. The markets out there are even bigger. And if you do not understand or define as closely as you can who will be interested in what you're doing, all of your marketing efforts will be diluted into nothing. You have to define your customer to the point where you can focus your marketing efforts. Our customer is a woman between 24 and 44. Owns the house she lives in, usually married, with a high income. You have to find yours. That market is in the United States, and it is not in Chile. Not because there are not people that have those characteristics. Just not enough to support a company. My company, my product, maybe if I had other products, sometimes food is easier, local. It's not my product. So critical mass is something to be kept in the list of setting yourselves up. Where is your market? Where are there enough buyers for what you want to sell? And usually, in the times we live, it means that you need to address the market globally. This is closing. I want to share a story with you that happened to me just this past January. I went to Santiago and I went to the company, to the building you just saw. And I saw that they were getting ready to export that day. So everybody was very busy and I thought, oh, I am not, I'm going to get in the way of everybody. So I better leave. So I told them, I said, you know, I'm going to come back tomorrow because today I'm just going to make everybody's work a little bit tougher. It's no point in leaving. So as I left, one of the seamstresses came out, and I looked at her and I said, "You dress so nicely." And she said, "Well, I'm going to my daughter's graduation, school graduation." I said, "Well, congratulations." She said, "Yes." And before you left, she asked me to give you a hug, mm-hmm. and I wanted to say thank you. She said, "If it wasn't for the opportunity I found here, where I came in knowing nothing, I would have not been able to educate my children. And I'm going today because my daughter, it always gets to me, my daughter has received a presidential scholarship and she's going to the university. So I share this with you because in the end, everything I have talked about, everything I have said is for that. It's for that moment. And I felt, oh, I did a good job. Okay. That's all.
Well, I didn't know the woman I had at Vietla today. Thank you for being with us. So my suggestion, we have drinks and everything later, but I know few are eager to ask many questions,
yes.
And I'm not a good moderator. So I will appoint Sarah to come to moderate the next half hour.
So can you take
me? Yeah, of
course.
So Sarah is also a social entrepreneur.
Trying to.
And she's one of the most creative person I know.
Trying to. Assalamu alaikum, shalom, ça va? So it was amazing. Thank you a lot, such an inspiration.
Thank you.
Who has some interesting question?
Thank you, Isabel, it was amazing. I just want to ask you, before you said that you had to quit your job to take care of your daughter because she was vulnerable and so, and I want to ask you later when the company gets bigger and so, how did you manage to have a good work life?
Okay, the way I did it, the way I did it was in my home, I created an office that had a direct entrance from the outside. So I had two secretaries there. And I had, at about 5 minutes, a distribution center. I operated like this, so when I have three daughters, in the middle of this, I have the babies. So I would be working and I would have one daughter in my knee and looking at the computer and, you know, how women do it. The first person I hired was to help me with everything in the house, so that maintenance was not something I needed to worry about. I think this is something that is very close to women. I think it's very important to accept help, that you don't have to do everything in the game, you know. Yeah, I mean, I had a lot of education. Why couldn't I help somebody else that didn't have that opportunity to earn a living and at the same time free myself to build a company? So I say this because it is very hard for women to take naturally help. You know, men very naturally take the secretary, make the call, give me reason. Well, it's a different reality, and I think that I strongly suggest that you keep in mind this idea that you reach out for help to build a company. But in terms of presence, I was in my home with two secretaries until my youngest daughter went to high school and she was driving herself.
How long?
17 years.
But I think life balance is a question that today with the entrepreneurship world starts earlier than just having kids. We become, as entrepreneurs, really workaholic and we spend all our time in the office or with our team, which are our best to delegate the work, but in the end we want to be there and we want to lead and manage. What do you think life balance is about?
I think the
time for yourself?
I think I was talking with my cousin, Rodrigo.
Nice to meet you.
But we have the whole family here.
Yes. but he brought up something because we were visiting in here in Tunisia and a place where they make this very nice cheese. And they have done such a lovely job. Mm-hmm. And he said to me, you cannot do this if you don't love it.
And I think this is true for entrepreneurship. There is a love, there is a passion that's going to keep you up many nights, and that has been true for me as well. With children, without children, with whatever it took. Whatever it took, I put forth the effort, the best as I could, constantly, and many times, long hours. My main goal was to be there, to pick up my children from school, but I organized every morning what every child needed, and then sorted that out, worked out everything I needed to do for the family.
So it's not more about prioritizing or time management, but it's more about doing it with passion and love, and that will lead you to balance your life.
And you can. Yes, and also to accept that there are stages. There are stages in building a company. You know, when you're starting, and there's a lot of trial and error. I mean, you're going to fail at some of the things you do. Some things are not going to work. In this process, you invest more. Eventually, things are very settled. It took a long time for me to have the team where I can be 4 weeks in Tunis, and I know everything's working.
Amazing. I guess we have a question right there.
Can I say that? Please. Thank you.
I'm close to that.
When you decided to start, the bank refused to give you money. Your husband also. So how you did it? Yeah, so how did you start? This is the first question. And the second, how many employee women you have now?
I started with very little, like six dresses. I did that like this, and six dresses, you know, were not very much. And then I went to a store, and then they ordered 54 dresses. And they paid me for 54 dresses. Was my capital. And then the next time I sold 75. And then the next time I sold 100. And so that's like 6 months long. But it's the way it happened. And there's it's not a problem to be slow. I had a lot to learn and I had a lot to balance. I mean, what matters is that in the end it works.
We always start asking about how much people you start your company with, but at some times when you have, we have a long experience, we pass by a lot of stages. You have a big team, and then you have a cash problem, so you need to fire people. Did you pass by that period?
I have never fired.
Yeah. Bigger permission.
Now the reason for that is because when the economic crisis came to 2008-2009, what we did is we didn't have enough work, there wasn't enough money, everything collapsed. This is in the middle, this is only 10 years ago. We divided the work so that everybody would get a little bit and everybody could keep some degree of income until things got better. So, unless you're a thief, you'll never be fired.
And we have a curious lady in here. She should have the hand for a question.
I didn't answer one of the questions.
Yeah. How many women?
We started with 21, and now we have an extension of about 100 people that work for the company. But in the company, I think this is important to give you a perspective that is more attainable. In the company itself, in the headquarters that you saw, we have about 15 people. And then the rest of the people work from their homes because that's the way they can take care of their children. They take whatever they are able to do and then they bring it back. And you know, if they don't know how to do something, we teach them. And if they need support to get machines or something, we try to provide them, to provide independence.
I want to know why this choice to not sell in Chile. Actually, I found a social enterprise 3 months ago, and for me, it's a pride to value the work of the artisans in their own country. So I want to know why don't you sell in your own country, even if it's a little market.
We had a store initially. No, we had it. We don't have it. We had a store. But it took so much from us that again, one of the things that I have learned the hard way, because when you have an entrepreneurial spirit, you can always do more. It's very hard to come to the conclusion that in order for things to work better, you need to do less. And you have to be selective, and not all options are open. It was too much energy for the return. I was risking the stability for putting energy into something that could not produce the return.
It's more of a marketing situation or strategy, right?
It is for me, it's a very practical solution. I mean, if it's taking more than what you can afford, then you are risking what is working well. Mm-hmm. So that is the solution. I mean, I would like to. It would be lovely, but it's not viable, really.
I just have a remark. Now I understand what's big corporation, really. Mm-hmm. By listening to you, I really understand what's big corporation.
Oh, wonderful.
Because you're doing good, I mean, you only get rewarded. You're not hungry, you're someone who...
Thank you very much.
I guess today you did touch a lot of social entrepreneurs, inspired a lot of them.
So I have a question about emotional and mental health. Like you mentioned the two words, pain, it was painful and it was lonely, and that's entrepreneurship. Even if we are surrounded by 100 people, we are seeing something that nobody else is seeing, and this is the meaning of being lonely. How did you deal with emotional and mental health during your journey? And if you have an advice, because this is something sometimes that we are ashamed or we are shy to talk about in our culture, do you have an advice for entrepreneurs in general and social entrepreneurs to ask for help and to understand that they are going through something invisible or and painful?
It's really, let's say, a trendy topic today in our generation of entrepreneurs, this matter of mental health, because we are under a lot of pressure, and at a young age, we start doing a lot of things, and we aim always to succeed in what we do and to be number one. And at some point, you don't know what to do, and you feel a lot of overthinking and depression, and start thinking, why did I start that? Should I do it again? And everything. And at some point, with 25 or more years of experience, I guess you have some advice to say.
I don't know. I think you would have to ask my daughters and my husband.
What did you do to him?
Yeah, right, that's what I mean. You know, I'm sorry.
You're bad.
I have to say something, and I think that this is true for all entrepreneurs. The word difficult is not one that one talks with oneself. We don't. You just do it. And there is a price for that, as you're saying. You start going crazy, a little neurotic, and all of the things that come with too much pressure. I can only say, find a group of people that you can be honest with. I don't know that I had it, but they are there. Yes, it's what I mean. So find a group of people, and especially men. I think women, the culture allows us to talk more.
Yeah.
And to share feelings more. And I think for men, this is a much harder thing, but also the pressure for you, even from society, in that respect of producing, is harder. So having a group of people that you can say, I am afraid to fail. I am afraid to fail. Because there is no entrepreneurship without the fear of failing. So how do you cope with that? And that comes and goes, because you're going to face many forces that are beyond you. Some things you can understand, and some things you can try to address ahead of time, arrange, and work. But there are many forces out there that you cannot anticipate that will impact what you do. Some will help you, and others, like for example, there was a big storm in a market in New York that I was not going because I didn't have enough time. Well, nobody went to the market, they went to the one I was. So it was a bit of a disaster, but it helped me. So what I mean is, there are forces out there in nature, in politics, in power struggles that are going to impact what you do.
Yes. There are waves that you have to surf.
Yes. Find people where you that you can actually express your fears. That's all I can think.
But to address. Without making them, without them like, becoming more fear, more fear than I do.
In the end, you have to address that belief that it's worth
finding a reliable partner or friendship. We have another question.
Thank you. Just are all your supply chain are ethical, or there is some manufacturing steps are not ethical? This is the first question.
In my company.
Yes, for you. And the second, ethical product is cheaper or expensive than normal product in the market.
I believe everything we manufacture falls within the guidelines of ethical. Absolutely everything. To the extent in which more and more I am avoiding buying raw materials unless I understand that they involve fair treatment of. Is this more expensive? Yes, it is more expensive. That's why I was clear from the beginning that the only place for our products was the top of the market. Because first, I cannot compete with mass production that was eventually going to come from India or India or China, 30% of all where it comes from China. So I cannot compete. I'm never going to be mass. What I learned is that there's a lot of people that are willing to pay more if you offer more. And I had to have faith in that.
I think someone else has a question. Do you have a question? I see. One of the things that you've talked about before.
Daniela is the daughter she was speaking about.
I'm actually here in Tunisia because of what I've learned from her. I work for the United States Embassy. I work in the economics office. And I joined the Foreign Service because of the sense of service, of being able to help others. And so my mother is an awesome example of that, but as is my father, who's a physician. So they both provide that example. But what I was going to say is what you often bring up is to differentiate between what is a problem and what is an obstacle. Or how to define that so that you can formulate your strategy on how to attack the problem, if it's a problem, or how to get around the obstacle. And I think that that goes to balance as well. It's how do you define what you have in front of yourself? Do you see it as something that's going to stop you, or can you find a way around it? And if you can't find a way around it, is there another path that you can take? It doesn't have to stop you. Sometimes it will. It means you need to find a different path.
I think she answered.
I love this energy. I think we need the husband to say something at some point.
No,
no.
You want to say something?
Sure. I've learned a lot. First of all, trust. You know, trust doesn't come easy when you're a man. Particularly, you know, 30 years ago, 40 years ago, and we've been married, what, 44 years now. You know, 44 years ago, the world was a little different than it is now. So I hope I've learned a lot. But that issue of trust is very significant in how you approach this. You know, I think she's been extremely trustworthy herself. I don't think she's ever said a lie in her life. She's dealt with people face to face. She can talk to someone without an education in terms that they can understand and bring dignity to the human being. I think that she's been trustworthy to those who have trusted in her, you know, with money, with credit, with you name it. And when she's not been able to meet the moment, she's been very clear and come to them before she failed and said, I've got a problem. Just like you were saying, your mental health, come to someone and say, I got the problem, and it's been able to work it out. I think it's also instilled something that this company has brought to us as a family. We all immigrated. We went to the United States because of my career, and I'm very happy with my career. I did something I wanted to do and I loved to do, but also it took everybody away. But her company kept our family together in Chile, and our kids, our children, our daughters know Chile probably better than we do. We left the country 40 years ago, and they feel very comfortable in the country. So we've gained an enormous amount, and it has nothing to do with money.
Thank you a lot for this testimony. Amen.
Extremely humble. What we heard today. We are extremely lucky to have you today, not only you, but the whole family. I wish my daughter would say the same, as you said. Three things, we always talk about them here, and I find them so clearly today. Number one is life is about transfer of trust. The value. And before you were speaking about trust, we were talking here where life is really about transfer of trust. I trust you, I do business with you. I trust you, I spend time with you. I trust you, I vote for you. I trust you, I lend you money. I trust you, etc. And this trustworthiness is honestly the biggest asset anyone can have. We are as much rich as the trust people have on us. The second thing I heard today, and we talked about it, because we are funded by a bank, that business is also about sharing risk. Sharing benefit, but sharing risk. And in tough times, when you share the risk, even sharing your mental risk with your friend is extremely important. And the third thing, which will probably we have a habit here to keep quotes, and we attach that to one person, is the quote that will remain from you is Mr. Quote. That almost the same is not the same.
Please. Wow.
honestly, almost the same is not the same. And that is exactly what makes the difference between a successful entrepreneur or successful person and or a product and the non-successful the product. Thank you very much. I have few thoughts and a small gift for you, which I prepared. I hope that you didn't get it yet. This is a Le Bardo Museum book, which, as you know, we have the. You visited the Bardo Museum.
I've given them a 3,000-kilometer tour of Tunisia, so we've been from the Bardo.
But not the Bardo?
They've been to the Bardo.
Oh, okay. Excellent. So I'm really happy, and thank you very much for being here. I probably would abuse your generosity. And maybe with Daniela, we will cut if we can get half an hour of your time every 6 weeks or so to be a senior mentor of one of our startups.
Well, maybe somebody needs to come to Canada.
So we can start up with Daniela. And the third thing which came to my mind when you were talking, we have, what's Khadija? Khadija, fantastic architect, and she made this magazine, La Gazelle, that you find in Tunis. She made it readable. She's the redactor, the editor-in-chief for the last few months. And as you may realize that this thing became readable, it was not readable at all a few years ago. There is interesting articles, not the ones on Gazette only, but the other ones. So I was thinking, if Khadija, Isabella, if you have time, to talk about social entrepreneurship with standards. Because everybody, you know, says, everybody says, I have a quality product or a quality manufacturing or quality factory. Until there is ISO, and then I have quality because they have ISO, so on and so. And in social enterprise, everybody's saying, I have a social enterprise. Mm-hmm. And I had always issue with that until I discovered a standardization company which gives the B label. So maybe in your effort to educate us, combining Isabel's experience and B, and what is the real social enterprise and the standardization we are going, maybe there is something here.
Yes, of course.
Okay.
Happy to hear. May I say something? What Daniela just said is true. We went around, I was like, the very, very countries inside the caves, and I'm not talking about Star Wars, that's not we went absolutely everywhere. I am completely in love with the country.
We are.
We went to the artisanal shop.
Yes.
Then it is frightening.
You have to go
across the hall from Antarctica. Dear goodness, I mean, it is so extraordinary. Find a skill. Do something very, very, very well. Be your best self critic. Most of what I have achieved is out of sheer fear. I'm not kidding. I always thought everybody else knew more than me. I just tried really hard. So it isn't like, I'm always distrustful of overconfidence.
Okay.
Oh, that's probably a trouble. No, be self-critical, find out who's the best, and find out how to do it better.
Thank you. So we have a habit that will write these sentences almost the same. It's not the same. No. So please silent. Then we will put it, we'll frame it. We'll print it and we'll frame it. That will be your coat.
And the name, please.
The name.
Thank you. Thank you.